Welcome to the BHB Trilogy podcast, episode 16, with Focus and Beast. I'm your host, The Sauce, and we're here with Mr. Beltran and Mrs. Beltran. So first, Mr. Beltran, can you tell us like some of your background info and like where you went to school and everything like that?
Yeah, certainly. Well, first of all, thanks for having me on the show. It's been a pleasure. My name is Jonathan Beltran, and currently I'm a senior project manager at Keck Medicine of USC, which is an academic medical center based here in Los Angeles. And I've been working there for about going on 4 years. And some of my background, currently I'm getting my MBA at USC as well, and have a background in a bachelor's in business. So it's a wonderful time to be in healthcare right now, to be able, especially with the current situation going on, global pandemic. Wouldn't have it any other way.
How long have you been at Keck?
Keck, going on 4 years. Close to 4 years.
4 years?
Yeah.
All right, Mrs. Beltran, can you tell us some of your background info?
Hi, so my name is Claudia. I'm currently working as a nurse in a pediatric location. My background would be, I always wanted to be a nurse. Now I'm in my current job. I've been there for 2.5 years. I don't know, what else would you say?
It's a lot you've been doing.
How did you get into your field? How'd you get into your field?
Well, I always wanted to be a nurse. I always wanted to be in the healthcare. At first, growing up, I always wanted to be a pediatrician, but being a pediatrician comes with many, many years of school, so that came out of the books. And then when I really decided I wanted to be a nurse was when my grandfather was actually coming in and out of the hospital, and I came across a lot of good things in the hospital and a lot of bad things in the hospital. And I think that was when I was really motivated to be that change for that person coming in when they're the most vulnerable.
That's great. So Stella will ask you the first question. Stella,
my first question is for Mrs. Beltran. What is the coronavirus and what are the symptoms?
So the official name they gave the coronavirus was COVID-19. It's a new virus. We've never dealt with something like this. And with that being said, the coronavirus, it's a virus. So we have no type of medication, no antibiotic, no vaccine, nothing that we can possibly give to these patients. So it's a respiratory infection, it's an illness. So meaning that it triggers your lungs, and that's where we see a lot of the difficulty breathing. Some of the symptoms that come with it, in the beginning, every day we're learning something different. So in the beginning, it was a lot of fevers, cough, shortness of breath. Now, or if you have traveled to the country, now we're screening every patient like they have the coronavirus, and we're looking for any fevers, any cough, any shortness of breath, sore throats. And traveling at this point doesn't matter to us. We're treating everybody as if you have it. And we're just facing everybody the same.
So, Mr. Beltran, how are you using your position at Keck to inform the public of corona and symptoms?
Yeah, definitely. It's a great question. I'm in the marketing and communications department. So right now, we're definitely heavy on the communication side, and we're in what we call a crisis communications mode, right? So it's important for us as a business and hospital within the community to deliver the right messaging at the right time about how we're taking care of our patients, how we're preparing for their care, and disseminating the messaging from our leadership, both internally across the organization and out to our neighborhoods and our patient population. Whether that's our social media channels, right, monitoring all of our channels to see what questions people have, to ensure that we have the websites up to date with reliable information in a timely fashion, and also email communications constantly from, you can imagine, the various amount of departments that we have, department heads and leaderships and deans, deploying all of that messaging and then bringing it back to leadership to see how to respond.
This question from Mrs. Beltran: how contagious is the virus?
It's very contagious. We know that it's droplet, meaning that it can live on surfaces, and it's also airborne, meaning that the particles are up in the air. So with that being said, let's say you go to a supermarket, or you go have, let's say, you go to the movies with your friends, and you sit on the seat, and you touch the seat, and then you go and you grab, or you touch your face, like your mouth, your ear, your nose, or your eyes. That's a mode of the virus to come into your body. As well, if somebody coughs on you, or you're not keeping your distance and you're breathing that same air that that person is, that is another mode of transition that you can get the virus. So I would say it's pretty, it's a pretty bad virus. It's highly contagious.
My next question is for Mr. Beltran. What kind of questions do people ask about coronavirus?
What kind of questions do people ask? As they pertain to my role at Keck, going back to monitoring the websites and social media, people are wondering how our hospital is responding to the virus, right? How are we preparing? How our supply levels are? How are we taking precautions and keeping our patients safe? And what are those protocols that we're taking? So they're definitely worried, asking a lot of those questions, and they want answers, right? And now in the digital media, you're expected to answer as quickly as possible. The problem is that we don't always have the answers right away, unfortunately. You would think that we knew, but this is something totally new, and we prepare all the time at the hospital in crisis communications for earthquakes, power outages, a bunch of scenarios like this, but this is something that's so left field we never expected. It's a learning experience. I think we're getting better at it as time goes on, but those are the primary ones that people are asking, is how are we preparing? And they also want to know transparency, right? They want us to be honest and transparent about how many people are infected at our facilities, how many tests have we given out, and things of that nature.
So, Mrs. Beltran, how can we protect ourselves from it? And like, how do you protect yourself as a nurse dealing with sick patients?
So, I'll do the first one. How we can protect ourselves, you have to want, I know there's, it's funny to me because a lot of people are looking for hand sanitizers and you can't find any anywhere. But just wash your hands. Wash your hands as much as possible. You want to wash your hands at least 20 seconds. For at least 20 seconds, and the way that you know you're washing your hands for at least 20 seconds is by singing happy birthday 2 times. So you can do that. It's as simple as that. Another thing you can do is avoid touching your face. Don't touch your mouth. Don't touch your eyes, because that's all, like, how can I say it? That's, your mouth is moist. It's wet. So viruses love that. They love to enter the body that way. So avoid touching your face. Wash your hands, clean your surface areas, like when you come home, wipe down your knob, just try to do stuff like that. If you do have to go out and you do have a mask, wear gloves, throw them away before you come into your house. If you have, leave your shoes outside. How I'm protecting myself, or I'm trying to protect myself, at work, we have different regulations. When this all started, we were just wearing a mask, regular surgical mask. Then we eventually had our urgent care for all those kind of patients, and then we had to gown up, including like a gown, a mask, a face shield, a hairnet, and then even covers for your shoes. Now, because we're treating every patient as they have it, we're walking around with a face shield and a mask. Your face shield can come off in between patients, but your mask should not come off at all times. Not even if you're just sitting there charting, it shouldn't come off. Coming home, I do have a separate pair of shoes. When I leave work, I change out my shoes, and when I come into the house, I leave those shoes out. As I'm walking into the house, I'm going straight into the restroom to take a shower. I'm getting that clothes, and I'm separating my uniforms from all the other clothes. And at the the same thing I practice. On the weekends, I try to wipe down all the surfaces that we have, like all the light switches, the doorknobs, just trying to prevent from me bringing anything back and having, you know, Jonathan get anything.
Does it feel like uncomfortable knowing that patients can have coronavirus and like knowing that people are dying?
Yeah, of course, especially in the beginning. In the beginning, it was really scary. I remember my first encounter where I had to go into a room and actually perform the test because the patient was showing all the symptoms. You always think like, so my first encounter was, I was gowning up, I was putting on my protective gear, and I was thinking, man, like, what if this person does have it? As I'm walking to the room, I'm thinking to myself, okay, this is how I'm gonna perform the swab, this is how it's gonna go, I'm gonna put it here, do it like this. And when I'm exiting the room, it's a specific way I have to take off my gear. I can't just take off my face shield and my mask. It has to come in order. So I didn't want to miss a step. I didn't want to take off my mask and my shield in the room. So it was just very scary knowing you're coming back or you're exiting that room and you're like, even like, ooh, I don't want to do anything. I don't want to work anywhere. I just want to go home and take a shower.
Yeah.
So it's scary. But I try to, you know, you try to stay positive and you remind yourself why you chose this path. You know, you want to help everybody and you want to treat everybody with love and respect and just try to give them the best care that you can possibly give.
This question is for Mr. Beltran. Do you have different messages for different people?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that again?
Do you have different messages for different people?
Different messages for different people. With regard to COVID-19,
the stages. Ages.
Okay, yeah. Just for everyone, just to, take all the precautions you can, right? No matter your age group. Because we're all impacted by it, even though you may hear a lot of the news that we're, you know, younger people are stronger and they may not get as affected, but the older population, they could be abuelita or grandma or, you know, so we have to take care of one another, and anybody is susceptible to get it, right? You have young people in ICU now. I think there's more people. Was it more younger people in ICU than older people now?
Yeah.
Perhaps not as many fatalities or deaths, but definitely people are hurting no matter what age you are. So just take it take it seriously right now. Just stay home. Take the time to just be home and stay with your family.
Stay quarantined.
Yeah, stay quarantined.
So Mr. Beltran, like, when you see more young people come in, is it surprising?
Is that for me? Yeah, I was even online the other day and I was reading an article that said that a 17-year-old got it and passed away. I think that's the youngest that has passed away. So really, anybody can get it and anybody can pass it along to anybody. And it's crazy because at first you think, oh, that can't happen to me. I'm healthy. I take vitamins every day. I work out. But even those people are getting the virus.
So in the beginning, were there like a lot of young people, old people, like a lot of old people?
I think that's what the biggest one was, the older, the people that don't have the best immune system, those were the ones that were getting sick and landing in the ICU, but now we're seeing every age group.
Alright, a quick break from our sponsors. Podcast episode 16, we're here with Mrs. and Mr. Beltran, and coronavirus is really affecting all our lives, and it's big changes to our lives. No school, no sports, nothing going on outside. We have to stay inside. So, of course, we had to bring doctors in. So, Mr. Beltran,
this question is from Mrs. Beltran. Why is staying at home and social distancing important, even if you are not at home? At high risk.
Say that again.
Why staying at home and
having technical difficulties. I don't know why she's laughing. You're going to say? How do you Ms. Mrs. Beltran, why is staying at home and social distancing important even for groups who are not at high risk?
And going back to what we were saying earlier, you can get this by breathing it and by touching. So if you're going out and not staying home, you can contract the virus. So it's really, really important to stay home. We're trying to cut it back. We're trying to stay healthy. We're trying for the virus to not infect as many people as in New York. So just stay home. Try to you know, come up with different things so you're not bored at home. Puzzle, books. I know that can be a little boring sometimes, but it's better than going and going through the virus, having the virus, because I've heard the symptoms are horrible.
So, like, how serious is it when it, like, gets to your, like, throat, right? Is that what it affects?
Yeah. So, in different people, the virus acts different. It just depends on your own body. But let's say you are immunocompromised, so you have, like, let's say diabetes, or you have hyper blood pressure, and or let's say you have cancer, your system is going to go very low, so the virus is going to attack you, and once the virus attacks your lungs, it can lead to pneumonia, meaning, like, there's fluid inside your lungs, so you can't breathe. So then, let's say you can't breathe, then they have to put a machine called the ventilator. It's a tube that goes down your throat, and it's breathing for you because your lungs aren't capable of doing that. At that point, you aren't awake, you aren't conscious. So it can really affect you.
So, Mr. Beltran, what kind of, like, emails are you sending out to, like, the directors and stuff?
Yeah, definitely. It's a lot about, again, I mentioned earlier, preparing or letting our patients know how we are preparing as a hospital and institution. Just last Friday, I sent out an email from our CEO, Tom Jakowicz, to a big portion of our population, letting them know how they can make appointments now, right? Because we've stopped all non-elective surgeries, and the vast majority of our clinic visits have come to a halt. So we are partnering with our IT folks and a lot of other departments to launch telecare and telemedicine, where you're able to talk to your doctors via an app, kind of like we're doing now, via Zoom, or more specifically, they have their own platform. So teaching the community that we have these tools available, and that if you need us, we're still here. And also that messaging, you know, some inspirational points in there as well, letting the community know we're one people, we're one community, and we'll get through this together. So things like that, right? And what else? Also, just letting know our constituents, like the main campus university, and other stakeholders, what are all of the projects that we're working on to combat this situation at the hospital. Right, like running a report, letting them know, hey, we're doing X, Y, and Z. We're trying to dot all of our I's and cross all of our T's. So a lot of that reporting. And I have team members that I'm working with too, like from the media team that I work with on a daily basis. They're the ones, they do some pretty cool stuff too. They're the ones kind of matching, like, doctors to television stations and radio stations. To put, like, let's say our chief medical officer at one of the community hospitals that we own, to put them on ABC or CNN, so they can get the word out for medical professionals. So things like, a lot of communication, things like that. That I've been kind of doing also.
So what's the, like, a doctor Zoom? Like, so you can Zoom a doctor?
Yeah, you can technically use, like, a Zoom, a HIPAA, what they call a HIPAA compliant Zoom, which I think
it's a little bit more complicated, right, than just Zoom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's pretty much for patient privacy, right? I think this account that we're talking about right now, saw it was like HIPAA compliance, so it's secured, right? You don't want, if you were going through something, that somebody hacks into it and finds out personal information about you. And there are other platforms that are coming out. But right now we are using what we're calling telecare. It's a white label solution to be able to diagnose patients. but it's a pretty interesting time for technology in healthcare right now.
Yeah. I ran out of your questions.
Can I
ask one more? Oh, you want to ask a question?
What do you guys think about the coronavirus?
Say the last part.
Like, within your age range.
I got sick before they closed my school down. So, like, I didn't go for, like, half the week. And, like, so, I mean, I got happy when it closed down. Everyone else got sad, but I was like, whatever. No more school. But, I mean, since it's, like, for young people, I don't think I'm as, like, worried. I mean, since it affects, like, older people, like, more, I'm not, like, as worried because I'm still young. Unless because my immune system isn't fully developed yet. But I'm not as worried as compared to, like, my grandparents.
Yeah.
What do you think?
I wasn't paying attention. I wasn't thinking about it too much, but then when they closed down the schools, it got serious, but then when they closed down the schools, like, until next year, and I got nervous, but I knew I probably wasn't going to get it, so I was just going to stay in my house.
I got sad and mad when they closed down the school.
That's what we feel like, because we're like, we're staying home, you know, like, we're listening to, like, stay home, to not affect other people.
Well, it sounds like you guys are taking it seriously, you know, even at your age range, I know it's impacting you guys a lot, right, in life, but.
Like, sports and everything, can play sports.
Yeah, sports, friends, it's history in the making. I think it's something to appreciate. Not that it's a good thing to have to go through, but it's literally what you're going through right now is history in the making, right? 10 years from now, you're going to be remembering this time and how much it changed the world. So just having a grasp of that, I think, kind of gives you an awe of it.
So I was going to ask both of you, what's the best advice for kids and teens like us?
Sure. So, are you asking for advice specific to COVID or, like, in general?
Like just whatever. Both.
I'll speak to, like, more general, and you're more closer to the medical stuff, so I'll just talk about Corona. But just in general, best advice I give to teens and kids: never underestimate the impact that you can have on those around you and others. Right? If no matter how small of an action, you never really know how that small action can have a positive or negative effect on your friends or your family or somebody watching you, either through your podcast or in a simple conversation, right? You never know when you flapping your butterfly wings, how that can have a monumental effect on the other side of the world, right? That power, that potential right there is incredible. I've always told your dad, I think it's amazing that you guys at your age are doing this, right? Because you're going to reach. You don't know what one kid is going to see this and will, I think, be inspired by what you're doing. So don't take that lightly. And just run with it for yourself.
So the best advice I can give to with the coronavirus, I would say take it serious. You know, like Jonathan was saying, it doesn't matter. The little grain of salt that you bring in can be the biggest difference. You know, you have mom and dad at home, you have grandparents at home, and you just want to keep them in mind because you can be coming home and you can be giving them something. And the saddest thing that I was seeing when I was reading an article, it was these patients that are dying, they're dying by themselves. There's no family with them, there's nobody to hold their hand, so they're dying by themselves. So what I always tell myself, I haven't seen my parents in a while, but I always say, I wouldn't want that for them. So that's why I'm keeping my distance, and that's why I'm coming home, I'm going straight into the shower, even to protect Jonathan. So I would say take it serious, stay home, listen to your parents, and you know, we'll all get through this. I saw a thing that I really liked. It said, be aware, not anxious. So just be aware of what's going on, but don't go to the point that you become anxious and you can't live your regular life.
Well, thank you for being on our podcast. Those really good answers. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Really not. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Appreciate you too. Signing off. Speech between